Welcome. Thank you all for joining us today for our webinar where Mega Subramaniam and I are going to be sharing some of the resources we've developed as part of a four-year IMLS grant that is wrapping up today. And these resources are to help both library staff and the patrons they serve to enhance digital privacy and security. So my name is Jessica Vitak. I'm the PI on this grant, and today I am joined by both Mega, who will introduce herself in a moment, as well as Nisa Esgarali-Hoffman, who has been a PhD student working on this project for the last year and has been really helpful in us developing some of these resources. Before I hand it over to Mega, I just want to give you a brief overview of what we're going to be talking about in the next hour. So Mega is going to give you some of the background on the project and what motivated us, some of our initial findings, been talking about digital privacy and why these resources are needed. So why do we need to be focusing on helping folks develop stronger privacy literacy? She's going to talk about some of the findings from our data collection with both patrons and library staff from around the US over the last several years, and some of the challenges that library staff face when trying to serve patrons and they're interacting with patrons and the patrons' sensitive data. And then after that, what we're gonna do is we're gonna give you a walkthrough of the website that we have just finished, talk about some of these resources, give you some of the links to the different resources, and then we'll take questions. If you do have questions, please use the Q&A button, which you should see in the bottom toolbar on Zoom. And then if it's an easy question that somebody can just answer through chat, Nisa or Mega or I will respond. Otherwise, we will cover that at the end. So with that, I will pass it over to Mega. Just let me know, Mega, when you want me to advance slides.
All right. Thank you, Jessica. We can go to the next slide. Hello, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you're watching from. My name is Mega Subramaniam, and I'm an associate professor at the College of Information Studies at the University of Maryland, also known as the iSchool. So I'm a co-PI in this work, and I was just delighted to be working with Jessica and Nisa on this project. So let me introduce you to the context of the work where we'll be sharing findings and insights from, which is the Safe Data, Safe Families project. This is funded by the Institute of Museum and Library Services. And thank you so much to IMLS for funding this work very generously. We've been working on this, believe it or not, a little over 4 years. So again, thank you IMLS for the patience and for allowing us to do this important work. So the goal of this work is to develop educational resources for low socioeconomic status families to reduce risky behaviors and enhance their overall privacy-related digital skills, as well as developing resources for library staff to better support this population that they normally assist in libraries. So next slide, Jessica. So you may ask, why specifically focus on low socioeconomic status populations? So these are populations that live either near or below the poverty line. And the reasons are, we have learned through our own work talking to families, one, socioeconomic status actually predicts home internet access, with the economically disadvantaged often having to turn to libraries to complete everyday online transactions. And they have increased privacy and security risks. Next click, Jessica, thank you. Technology and internet-related skills are lower among those with less income and education compared to those that have higher income and education. And next bullet. So the Pew did a study about 4 years ago that highlights a knowledge gap on privacy and security. On a 13-item quiz, they found that respondents with a high school education or less averaged only 4 correct responses compared to those who are college graduates who got more correct answers. So this population, low socioeconomic status population, is especially vulnerable to being targeted by scammers and others looking to take advantage of people that lack this knowledge, right? That have this knowledge gap. And our own previous work and others have found there is lack of research looking at privacy and security challenges and solutions for economically disadvantaged individuals and families. Hence, this is how our project is actually focused in helping this population. Next slide, Jessica. So you may ask, what is digital privacy? All right, so let's see what the general Americans think. So here's a study done by Pew 2 years ago, asking Americans for their own definition of the word privacy and also digital privacy. What they did is they collected these answers and then they coded it into broad categories. And what it revealed for both questions, meaning of privacy and meaning of digital privacy, is that participants or Americans generally mentioned that their concerns are about the role other people and organizations can play in learning personal things about them, their desire to shield their personal activities and possessions, and also they have interest in controlling who is given access to their personal information. What was interesting is that many of the respondents' written answers about their definitions of digital privacy actually repeated thoughts that were answers in about privacy, so essentially more or less the same. Except that words like social media, online, internet, and data were more common when respondents described digital privacy. So really, in people's life, their online and offline worlds do connect, and it's really clear from this answer. Next slide, Jessica. So how do people fare then in when it comes to digital privacy? So as I mentioned before, low socioeconomic status populations have lower digital privacy literacy because of the reasons that I had just mentioned. Here are some findings of our own work as we talked about families and also from others. So the first bullet, thank you, Jessica. Many believe that the existence of a privacy policy means that companies do not share personal information with others. We all know that it's not true. In fact, privacy policy actually indicates, right, where this information is being shared. And we all know these policies are terribly long and nobody actually reads it. Second bullet, lack of understanding of relevant cybersecurity topics was really, really huge, such as not understanding what private browsing means, encryption, or VPN. Next bullet. Also, many do not know that companies can legally sell consumer data to others or even charge different types of prices based on such data. And the last bullet, I think that's one more. Okay, so losing money was another thing that we saw through our own research. So many of the people that we talked to, the families that we talked to, describe examples of having credit card information stolen or compromised, or experiencing just negative financial outcomes. In many cases, what we found, the combination of being poor and belonging to another vulnerable group, such as being an immigrant or being an older adult or being a child or being disabled, actually makes one a particularly tempting target for scammers. The last bullet, Jessica. Also, we found in general, people are not able to respond to email or social media account hacks. So next slide. So let me tell you a little bit about how we went about developing the resources for library staff and families before actually showing you what we have developed. As researchers, we collect data, and based on the data, we develop these resources. So this is not something that just comes from Ivory Tower. It's actually something that we co-designed with library staff and also children. So let me tell you how we did it. So we did 11 focus groups at conferences with 36 public library staff nationwide. And I will tell you a little bit after this what we found out. We also interviewed 52 families from low socioeconomic status population in the state of Maryland. So we got the help of 4 library branches in Maryland in high poverty communities that span both rural and urban locations. If any of those branches are here today, thank you so much for helping us out throughout this research. We also partnered with a local nonprofit, Latino and Immigration Advocacy Organization, to recruit participants who offered perspectives from immigrant population and those who spoke English as a second language. So in these interviews, we talked about their technology practices, challenges, barriers that they face when they're using technology. Specifically, of course, we were more interested to explore the privacy and security risks that these families face when using digital technology. So once we have learned about the challenges that low socioeconomic status families face in terms of digital privacy, as well as challenges that library staff face when they assist patrons with everyday online transactions, we started developing the resources for library staff by doing 4 co-design sessions with 22 library staff nationwide. And Jessica will be sharing the results of the resources that we have developed shortly. And then to develop resources for library staff that they can offer as programming for youth and families, as well as to develop resources that youth can use and interact on their own. We conducted 3 co-design sessions with Kids Team at the University of Maryland. So Kids Team is an intergenerational team consisting of 8 children ages 6 to 14, as well as adult co-designers. So Jessica, Nisa, myself were co-designers, as well as a few other graduate students, and also the Kids Team adults. There are some dedicated Kids Team adults that have been working with these kids for years. And as a result of that, we came up with the resources for the kids to use on their own, as well for library staff to offer as programming. And Jessica will also be sharing with these resources shortly. Next slide, Jessica. So earlier I shared with you some of the data points on digital privacy issues that patrons, people have from the family interviews that we did, right? Some nuggets that I shared with you. Now, let me share the challenges that staff have when they want to help these patrons. So in our focus group, library staff describe regularly providing support for patrons who have little to no knowledge of how to use the internet to complete life tasks, such as applying for housing, health insurance, completing tax form. And this all requires submitting PII or personally identifiable information online. So staff consistently shared scenarios where patrons ask library staff to complete online transactions for them, rather than asking them to teach them to complete these transactions on their own. So library staff highlighted how patrons were driven by immediate need. So as you can see here, I'll just read one of the quote that you can see. So there are people who just try to give you all of their information and they're handing you their credit card and they don't even stop to think that there might be an issue with that. Right? And if you read the second quote, you know, they leave their social security card on the copy machine, they're shoving their tax forms in your face. So we heard these things from library staff. So patrons' priority is to get things done and they care less about privacy. Next slide, Jessica. Liability concerns. Library staff that said to us, they often had to sit next to patrons and guide them through each step of an online transaction. Many staff actually expressed concern about being accused of making errors while helping a patron complete online transactions that involved PII. So here you can see a quote here from a technical services supervisor. I had a patron call who claims that one of my staff members signed her up for online social security and now she's not getting her paper checks anymore. She feels that her benefits were taken away because of her working with a librarian. I think that that's where the liability issues come in. So interesting conundrum here, right? Because if library staff choose not to help a patron because a task deals with PII, they'd be labeled as not being helpful or not doing their job. But if they do, they're blamed if the transaction was not successful. Next slide. Everyone trusts the librarian. Patrons appear to inherently trust librarians when it comes to handling PII. Library staff in our focus group described how patrons saw them as neutral entities and shared everything from family stories to financial information with them. So this is summarized nicely by this branch manager. I've not had the experience of patrons ever pausing to consider the privacy issues or later coming up and asking concerned about their privacy. This seems often like it never crosses their mind, which I'm not sure how much of that is not being educated enough, or whether it's a case of because we are in a trusted position. So next slide. Library staff described a range of library policies for handling sensitive patron information. However, very few libraries had detailed policies that tried to capture all the possible patron scenarios. Policies vary in terms of coverage. For example, some library policies are designed to address liability concerns by preventing staff from handling devices. So like this first one, we can help you as much as you can, as we can, but we can't do it for you. We cannot do it for you, and we can't touch your devices. Some library staff say they're willing to bend the rules to help a patron in need, such as the second one here. You may have to fudge the rules a bit just so that you can get, so that they can get unemployment benefits. You don't want people to starve or anything like that. So very few libraries have detailed policies. And next slide. However, what we found is many libraries actually have no policy. So librarians handle each patron on a case-by-case basis. But not all library staff actually felt the need to have policies. So for example, you can see here from one of the quotes, it would be awkward to have a policy. If we had a policy, we probably end up turning people away and saying, I'm sorry, we can't help you because this is outside of what we are allowed to do. And that would be a shame. So this sentiment here reflects the challenges that library staff may face in crafting a policy that enables them to accomplish their mission. Overall, all these situations actually highlight the tensions that library staff face when they're helping patrons with issues that I mentioned before. And patrons actually rely heavily on library staff to complete this important task and protecting themselves. Library staff have to think about protecting themselves and their libraries as well from potential legal issues. In many cases, we found that staff were very willing to put themselves at risk rather than turning away a patron in need. So with that, I hand it back to Jessica.
Great. And before we get into the resources, we have a quick poll. So you should see a poll right now. And what we want to know is, for those of you who have worked in libraries, and we recognize this isn't everybody on the call, but for those of you who have you experienced any of these challenges that Megha just went through in your day-to-day interactions with patrons? Okay, so seems like most folks have jumped in who are going to, and if you should be able to see the results. What we see is that for most of you, you have had it happen at least sometimes, if not often. So this does seem to be something that resonates with folks on this call, as well as the library staff that we've been talking to over in recent years. I do want to remind folks, I'm not going to jump into the resources right now. If you do have any questions, drop them in the Q&A, and either we'll answer them live as we're going through things, or we will just respond text-wise. But the Q&A button is the best way as we go forward. So now I am going to talk about the resources. So like Megha said, we spent several years talking to both families and to library staff, doing design sessions with library staff and then with children. And based on that, we've come up with a set of resources which are targeted both specifically at library staff specifically at families, and some that work for both. And it might just be a difference in how it's presented. So a lot of the games that we've developed for children can be embedded within libraries' programming resources, or they can operate as standalones. So I'm going to go through each of those. If you want to explore our site, the web address is safedata.umd.edu. Nisa, why don't you drop that into the, I guess, the chat, and if folks just want to click on that rather than having to write it out themselves. So the first thing I want to talk about is the resources we developed for library staff. And so one of these was training modules. And what we were interested in when we developed these training modules are, what are the different types of everyday interactions that library staff might have with patrons, where there might be an issue that's raised that kind of reflects these challenges that we discovered in our research? And can we have trainings that can help teach library staff how to respond to these types of scenarios? So we developed 8 different training modules. And I'll go to the website in a minute just to show you what that looks like. For each of the modules, we have an outline of what the training looks like, details on about how long we would expect it to go, the different types of groups it's appropriate for. So some might be more appropriate for a one-on-one interaction. Some might be better for large groups. And then we have files available for download for running the different training sessions. So let's go to that website. So I'm on safedata.umd.edu right now. And if I go to the resources for library staff, you're going to see the 4 categories of resources here. And the first one that we're talking about right now is training modules. So if I click into one of these, so let me click into customizing privacy conversations. What you're going to see when you go onto that specific training module is an outline here, and the text here is also reflected in the printable training instructions. So each training module will have a printout. It's all saved as PDFs that you can download. Each training has a learning objective, and so you can browse through the training modules to see, are these the types of learning objectives that would work well, that I want to run in my branch? Here we have the amount of time. Almost all of the trainings involve the use of personas. And I'll talk more about that in a minute and how we develop the personas. But what most of them are doing are trying to identify different patron needs, different concerns that might involve privacy, and have staff either through an interactive, through brainstorming, sticky noting, different types of activities, think about different solutions for that. And so if you look here, if you just hover your mouse over each of the trainings, you're going to see a brief description of each one. And just to show you another one, you know, they're very similar. They're all the format. They all have these materials needed here. And usually it's downloads, although I will say, which one? This one, how to create your own personas, does have some other things that you need. So probably the best thing to do is to, if you want to use this, if you think that this would be something that would be useful in your branch, just to browse through the different options that we have available, think about how much time would I have to do this, and use the learning objectives to customize it and figure out what's going to work best for you. So let me talk a little bit about personas. You might know what personas are, but if you don't, personas are fictional characters that are created based on research. And so what we did is we created these fictional characters. We created 6 different types of patrons based on our research talking with families and with library staff. And personas are nice because what they're doing is they're embodying common characteristics or experiences, or they can help you work through different scenarios. So as we did our research, we started to take note of common themes. What were the types of experiences, the anecdotes that we were hearing again and again? And from that, we developed six personas. I have two of them here. One is Julia, job seeker and emerging internet user. The other is Anthony, a first-time online shopper. And we have, for each of the trainings, we have these downloadable PDFs that have these personas that give you information and background on that character. So it's, you know, background on who they are and what their goals are with, when using technology, some of their personality traits, and then these scenarios in the library. And these, in different trainings, it might say you can use any of the personas. It might say this training works best with this persona. We might give an example with one persona, but it can be used in many. And then if you go back to the training modules, what you'll see here is if you click on the training materials, it has our six personas you see here. And then if you click on the persona download, that will give you the PDF of what I was just showing you in the PowerPoint, as well as a script and a video. And this is something that is demonstrating an interaction between a library staff member and that persona. So the video is just taking the script and it's animating it. So like that's one way of presenting it, or you could just use the script and have staff members be reading that as part of the training. And so, you know, what you might do is you might select a training where you can use any of the different personas, and you might look through these six options and decide, oh, well, this is one that fits very well into the kinds of interactions that we have in our branch. The other thing that we have is we created these six personas based on our conversations with library staff and with families, but we recognize that this is in no way exhaustive. And at your branch, you might have different types of common patron interactions that you want to help staff learn about how to best respond in different situations. So we also have a training module where you can create your own persona. And again, personas are developed not just, you know, out of thin air. They're usually developed on research. So we offer tips in this training for the different types of steps in how you would create your own persona. We provide a blank template if you want to build it out in a similar way in which we have built ours. And this has three sessions, which can be condensed, but the idea here is that through different meetings with different branch members, you can kind of come to an agreement about this is a persona that would work well when we're trying to do trainings or just help staff think through ways to respond to different types of situations. So that is our training modules. I want to move on so I can get through everything. Here's what our build your own persona template looks like. It's in it's a PowerPoint file available for download in that build your own persona training. And the next thing I want to move on to is the privacy policy framework. So Meg has shared that many of the library staff we talked to either said at their branch they have no policy or their policies are very limited. And what we wanted to do is try to help libraries that want to develop some kind of policy, even if it's a very broad policy that allows for that flexibility that many of the staff members said that they wanted, that they could help them get ideas on what that policy might look like. And we turned first to the American Library Association's Privacy Toolkit, which if you're not familiar with, we do link it on the website, and I'll show that in a moment. But that's dealing with kind of how to build a privacy policy at a high level. What we wanted to do is build a supplement to this privacy toolkit that would help libraries think about the different types of everyday interactions they have with patrons and the different types of challenges that might arise. So I'm going to go to the privacy policy framework. So again, if I go back to my resources for library staff, the second thing here is our privacy policy framework. And if you want to read up on the ALA privacy toolkit, like I said, it's right here. So what we did is after we had all these conversations with library staff about various challenges, we said, okay, well, what are the main categories of things that could be covered in different types of policies that would help minimize this liability, minimize privacy risks for patrons, and kind of find that middle ground available? So what we have in this privacy policy framework, we have several sections. And if you scroll down on this page, what you'll see is they're organized here into a first section, responding to patron requests, what staff can and cannot do, which is a broad introduction into this. We've set it up on the website, so it's an accordion. It just pops out and you can see this. But then we have these six main topic areas. So privacy at public computers, special considerations for minors, privacy when accessing third-party sites, when completing online forms, general concerns, and protecting financial information. And if you click into any one of these, what you'll see is each page is structured the same way and it's broken into three topics. One is kind of what are the key topics for this area? Recommended actions, so things that library branches can think about when they're making a decision, should we have an official policy on this or an unofficial policy, any type of policy? What are some of the recommended actions you want to think about? And then we pulled example library policies. So we basically went online, we looked across the US at a wide range of library branches, and we tried to make sure we were being diverse and not just focusing on kind of the big branches, which obviously have great policies and, you know, they're more developed. But so we tried to capture urban and rural and all parts of the country. And we pulled examples that speak to each of these categories. So why don't I go into special considerations for minors? And so this is what it looks like. So, you know, it gives you kind of a brief description of why this is a topic of interest. The key topics here, in this case, there are two key topics for policies that might be about minors, helping them protect their identity, and then social media issues. We have recommended actions. In this case, we point to a lot of law and the FTC, which in the US, the Federal Trade Commission, has a lot of good documents on this. So we say, oh, well, maybe you should consult this law, look at these documents. And then we have examples of library policy. So for example, the New York Public Library has a very detailed policy on this, San Antonio as well. We have a one line from the DC Public Library, but they all follow the same format. And then beyond that, we have two more sections. We have tips to communicate your library privacy policy. And so this is just giving advice on ways in which you can share this information with your patrons. And then additional resources, which includes all of the library branches we pulled examples from, as well as a few other resources. Now, we've broken up it this way on the website, so you can kind of quickly get to the section you want. The other alternative is that you can download a PDF version that has all of the sections. So I have that here. So if you want to, you know, just have this full document that I believe is 32 pages, we've set it up and we have it organized. Yeah, so it's all the same content. It's just in one document, which we thought for some folks that might be easier. So that's our privacy policy framework. Again, this is working, something that we want to work in conjunction with the ALA's privacy toolkit, which is more expansive. You know, we wanted to focus more narrowly on these everyday interactions. Okay, the third resource that we developed specifically for library staff, we call teaching moments. And the idea here is that library staff interact regularly with patrons. And sometimes that there might be an opportunity to introduce different types of privacy and security concepts, raise a point, share a tip that is specifically encouraging them to develop more kind of robust privacy and security practices. So what we did is we made handouts, and these are flyers. So if you look on the left hand of the screen, this is, you know, a standard 8.5 by 11 size page with, and there are about, I want to say 14 or 15 different topic areas. And these are things where you could download them, you could hang them up, you could just have them available for people to take. But then we also developed an annotated version of them. And that's what we see here on the right. And in the annotated version, what we do is we offer tips and examples for ways to talk to patrons about this. So, what, you know, maybe you're not super well versed in two-factor authentication. We have a handout on what two-factor authentication is. And then we also have a separate document that says, okay, here are some things that you know, specifically you might want to talk about. Here are situations in which it might be useful to bring this up. So in this example, we have setting up a social media account. And so we talk about, oh, well, if a patron comes to you and they're like, I want to set up a Facebook account. Well, sure, you can just say, okay, well, go to facebook.com, click the create account, do that. But you can also expand that to make that something where you say, oh, well, one thing you probably want to do while you're setting up your account is let's look at the privacy settings and see, so you can decide who you want to share content with. And so if we go to back to the website, I'm going to go to teaching moments. And then for each one, so here we have the list of everything. If you want to download a teaching moment, you just expand on that topic area. And let's see here. Most of them have the annotated, not all of them have the annotated, but most of them do have an annotated. We do also offer the handouts themselves in both English and Spanish. So you can download the teaching moment, the flyer version in English or Spanish, or you can download the annotated version in English for each one. And very straightforward in terms of doing it. We have, you know, a lot of kind of, we cover a broad area of topics here, as well as some that are specific to teens and specific to parents. So those are our teaching moments. Okay, next I want to go to some of the programming resources, and these are the games and other activities that we developed for families. And these are things that we list both in our resources for library staff section of the website, as well as our resources for families. And the first thing I want to talk about is a game we developed through working with Kids Team at the University of Maryland. And this game is called Password Mania. This is a card game with like regular card size cards. And the idea behind Password Mania is teaching children, teens, about what are the factors that go into a strong password. This was largely motivated from the fact that kids these days are using technology at earlier and earlier ages. They often have to have passwords. So, you know, most kids in school, certainly this past year with the remote learning, had to have accounts that needed passwords. And so if they're having to create passwords, the earlier we can help them understand what makes a password strong versus weak, and they can develop that security hygiene, it just becomes habitual that they have, that they use stronger passwords. So the goal of Password Mania is to teach them that. And so this is a card game. We say it's for ages 7 and up. For the younger kids, 7 and 8, they might need some assistance in order to play. But the idea is that you are dealt different cards. And here I have a couple examples of cards. And you're trying to get the best hand because most of the cards have a point value. And I have some of the, I can show you some more. Needs to be here. Okay, so this, let me do this. This is available in English and Spanish. The cards are broken up into multiple types. So length cards, add to your password's length. Characters cards are whether your password has letters, numbers, special characters, or some combination thereof. Content is like, what is actually in your password? Is it a set of random words? Is it your pet's name? These types of things. And the strong, the kind of things that are indicative of a stronger password are worth more points. We also added some wild cards that do various things, swapping cards, drawing new cards, as well as some bonus cards. And the bonus cards are reflecting things that are strong password practices. So this could be two-factor authentication, answering your security questions, those types of things. And so on the website, you can access by going to our programming resources. You can access here our instruction manual. You can download a card deck, set of card decks in English or Spanish, and then black and white or in color. We are also having card decks made. And so we note here that if you are interested in getting an actual deck of cards versus printing them out on your own, to use our contact page to request cards. So you can just fill out a request. It will be at minimum a few weeks before we actually have them in hand because they're being printed right now. And then we offer advice here for how library staff might integrate the game into their other programming resources. So like I said, this is something that library staff can kind of facilitate the playing of this game, or we can have people who are just, you know, doing it on their own. So that is Password Mania. The next resource is also about passwords. Passwords are super important. Passwords are something that I think is relatively easy to teach people about how to make them better. I think most people probably do not have the best password habits, and this is not just children, adults as well. And so I think reinforcing this throughout is a good idea. So the password worksheets are actually focusing on how to make a good password. You can make it long, and long passwords are always better. So if you see in this this shot of an example, it's a worksheet where there are multiple versions of them, and you pick four of the images, any combination, and then you try to come up with a story about them. This is inspired by a comic strip about passwords that I link on the website. But the idea here is if you take four words and put them together and you come up with a story that you can remember but doesn't make sense to other people, that's a great example. These are also available in English and in Spanish. Next, we have an escape room style game using Google Forms. So escape rooms are really popular in the physical world. And I think in the last year and a half, they've been used as an educational resource as well. And in the past year and a half, people have gotten creative with thinking about them. And a popular way of doing this is through Google Forms. And so this is targeted at younger children. We have it at the age range of 8 to 11, so elementary school age kids. We have this resource available in English and Spanish. And so if you click on the link, you go to a Google form. And this is called Island Escape. The idea behind this is you're trying to get off of the island before the quote bad guys get you. And so you go through this, and there are a number of challenges that you have to pass. And these are related. The challenges involve things like location data and passwords. You know, you have to hear you in the first challenge, you have to pick what the strongest password is. And it gives you information as you do that. And so as you go through, it'll let you know, oh, well, this is why this is a good password. These are why these aren't as good of passwords. So there is that kind of explaining. And then Nisa, our PhD student, did a great job illustrating these. Here we have another question with location data. As you work through the game, you get the questions right. If you get the question wrong, it tells you to keep trying. But the idea here is through storytelling, we can help reinforce some of these concepts. So again, that's available in English and Spanish. And then I accidentally left this one off. The other game that we have is for slightly older kids. We're thinking this is more of a middle school game. And if you're of a certain age, you probably remember Choose Your Own Adventure stories. They were one of my favorite things to read as a kid. And so we made one that is about, you're the main character and you are planning a surprise party for your best friend. Your best friend is very much trying to figure out if you're doing it, and you're trying to hide it from him. And so if you go to play this, we don't have the Spanish version online yet, but that will be available. I need to start over. So here you see it's called Marco's Surprise Party. And much like any Choose Your Own Adventure story, you have text. And again, this is illustrated by Nisa. I really enjoy the images. And then at some point, you have options, and you have, you know, maybe two or three options to choose from. Again, a lot of this is talking about cell phones and like different ways in which sharing their information might come back to bite you if you, I was sharing my location with my friend before, and now they know that I am at the party store type of situation. And so you go through this. If you, you know, some of the paths obviously end with your friend finding out, so you can start over. So it's very much like a Choose Your Own Adventure story. We're also gonna have audio available for these. One thing from talking with kids is kids often want stuff to be read to them. So we're gonna have audio options in both English and Spanish as well, where you can listen to the story and then you select. And this is also right off our main programming resources page. The final one is coloring pages. So we thought, how can we reach really small kids. So we have kind of the elementary age and the middle school age. What about the younger kids? Well, one thing we thought is a lot of libraries have story time or other events, or maybe they just have things like coloring pages or other activities for the younger kids. So we reached out to a artist, Yvette Wan, who created these pages for us, these images that are all kind of tech themed. And on the back of most of them, we have some conversational prompts. So the idea is that, you know, kids get to color, parents get tips on how to talk to their kids about social media and mobile media. And I believe I can show you, yep. So here is one example in that's in Spanish. So this is a social media themed one. So if you download the page, you get a 2-page PDF. You could print it front back if you wanted. And so there's the image on one side, and then the other are a set of tips for talking about social media. All of them are in both English and Spanish. So then for our families, all of these games are available to them. And if you go to our resources for families, you'll see two options. All of the games here are located in the same space. The main difference is that we don't have details on how libraries can use this as part of their programming, but all of the links are still there. All of the things to download are still there. But if you go to resources for families, we also have learn more about digital privacy and security. And this was taking our teaching moments and expanding on them, because these are all topics where I think a lot of folks just don't know a lot about, you know, what exactly is a phishing scam. You might have heard the term, but you don't know what to look for. You don't know what kind of the characteristics are. So what we did is we took our teaching moment, and we have them here where you can download them in English and Spanish, but we've expanded on describing them. So we've provided more detail. And so, you know, folks can download them if they want, but they can also just read through them and get more information about each of the topics. And you can, on the page, you can just click through and it'll take you down to one or the other. You can click back to the top if you want to go back to the top. So those are our resources for families. Again, very similar to the resources for library staff, slightly differently branded. The other thing I want to point out briefly before we go to questions is, you know, you can go click right here, or you can go back to our main page. We have details about the... we have details about the project and the background. All of our content is Creative Commons licensed, and so we have information on that as well as accessibility. We also have a link to all of our publications. So as this is academic research, we have published a fair amount on what we found in addition to the resources we've developed. So if this is something that you're interested in, you can access any of our publications, downloadable PDFs on this page. And I believe that's all that we have in terms of going through the different resources. I see that there are some Q&A and chat. So we can open it up to questions, clarifications, anything like that at this point. And I haven't been monitoring this at all. So Mega or Nisa, if you have anything that you are seeing in terms of this.
So Jessica, we've been getting some questions primarily on the policies, and I've been answering them on the Q&A chat. But one thing I think you may want to talk about is that sometimes, so I'm going to read this question loud. Sometimes what patrons need with assistance is not exactly a legitimate use of library equipment, such as falsifying or forging documents. How do you deny the patron assistance tactfully without excusing them at the same time? So I pointed to our tip to communicate privacy policy, but I believe that's also that we do have something that's embedded within other categories of privacy framework as well that I think we could Is there anything that I'm forgetting?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. And I'll give a shout out to another one of our coworkers here at the University of Maryland iSchool. His name is Dan Green, and he recently published a book called Promise of Access, in which he talks about digital inequities. And one of his case studies was the DC Public Library. And he actually shares a lot of stories about how library staff navigated that exact type of tension where people might've been using the computers to watch porn or engage in things that might, you know, be a little legally ambiguous. And that is not an easy thing to negotiate. And I think at some point you have to kind of think about what are the accepted norms for our branch, our community, have those conversations as a staff, because almost none of this is black and white. Yeah, and these decisions. And I, from talking with library staff, it very quickly became apparent that people's, who their population was that was using the branch, what part of the country they were in, like all of these factors shaped how they thought through these things. And I think more than anything else, it's important to prepare staff, especially new staff, but I think everybody as technology changes, to think about what are the potential problems that could arise, what types of situations might we have to engage with. And the more that you can be flexible in your response, I think the better. But I think that highlights such a good example of how hard these types of interactions are, and why there often isn't a clear policy, because it's not it always should be handled in one way type of situation.
Thank you, Jessica. And I think that's why we use the term recommended actions in mm-hmm. the privacy policy, because like Jessica said, every community varies. We do have a question, Jessica, that just came in. Will a recording of this presentation be sent out?
Yes. So if you have ever registered for a webinar before, and for this webinar, you got a reminder email. So anybody who registered for the webinar will get a follow-up email. What we're going to do is we're going to do some post-webinar editing, make the session a little prettier. We're going to post this on the iSchool's YouTube account, and then we will send out an email to all of you who registered, and you'll get a link. We're also going to add it to the website, but we expect that to be available mid-July. And so you should be on the lookout for an email. And of course, I want to just state that, you know the main website. As you're going through this, if you have any questions about the resources, if you want to ask questions, if you have ideas for different ways that these could be used beyond what we talked about, we would love to hear from you. I'll put up the slide again, which has our email addresses. There's also a contact page on the website. So, we would certainly love to hear from folks about how they might think about using these types of resources in their own branch, and what types of experiences that they think might happen.
Does not seem like we have any more questions.
Okay, well, now's your chance. If you do have some burning question, get it in now, because we are also approaching 5 p.m. So, this is a good time to end if folks don't have questions. And I just want to end by again thanking the IMLS, who graciously funded this account, all of the families, library staff that we talked to over the past 4 years, the kids we worked with as part of Kids Team, the four branches that we partnered with in Maryland as part of the early stages of this. It has just been a wonderful project. Mega and I are very, very happy to have been able to have the opportunity to do this. And we hope that these resources are useful to you if you do work in a public library, to you if you're a parent or you work in education. We really hope that you find these useful as you navigate this increasingly digital world that has many more privacy and security risks. So thank you for coming today. And that's all I have.